Okay, so moving on to the next question, how to deal with toddlers that don't want to finish their food. I know in respectful parenting, when the child says they're not hungry or they don't want to finish the food, then you don't force them to eat. Is that correct?
Yes, so there are a lot of things that children need us to be in charge of as they're growing because they don't have the ability to take care of themselves and keep themselves safe and do all those things that they need us for. So we do a lot. We have a lot of power, but there are areas that need to be in our child's control. And there aren't that many of them, but they do need to feel like empowered people and respected people. They do need to be in charge of certain things. And with this approach, one, we believe is their play, that they get to direct their play. And my mentor used to say, let the child be the director, writer, and lead actor of their play. So
I love
that area they need, and that becomes, as children get older, that becomes letting them choose. Like you heard my daughter say, they got to choose their hobbies. They got to choose what they want to do that day with their free time. They had that power. We weren't saying, oh, now you need to be drawing or now you need to take a lesson. It was up to them to decide those kinds of things. And another area they really need power in is to what food goes into their bodies.
Yes.
And we can imagine that. And we wouldn't want someone telling us, you have to eat this and you can't eat that. And what happens when we get in the way of something where we're trying to take power, where it's really our child's, is especially with eating, it's almost like they have a physical reaction, especially in these toddler years or like age 4, age 6 are kind of like this. Those are our years where our child is more asserting themselves to be their own separate person. So our child might actually, in their heart, really love broccoli, but because they know we want them to eat it all on their plate and we feel us staring them down or we're asking them or whatever it is we're doing, all of a sudden, I actually could not swallow that broccoli. It goes to a physical level for children. It's just not worth pushing, even to get what you want as a parent. If we just look at it that way, it's not worth pushing. And what we want to ideally preserve, like I was talking about, preserving that feeling of who you are and that calling and that passion in life, we also want to preserve that feeling of, oh, my tummy's telling me I'm full, or my body's telling me I need more starchy stuff right now. And I'm just not feeling the meat thing right now, or I'm not feeling the broccoli right now. So that is a precious message. That's a precious communication from our bodies, our tummies, to our brain that we are full, that we don't need this food, that we don't want to get in the way of that ideally. I think a lot of us as adults know what it's like to have that message be diluted.
I feel like my husband bribes our son, like, okay, if you stay here, you can get this. And I'm like, I don't know if that's the way to do it, but.
Yeah, I mean, it'll just work against you what you want ultimately, too. I mean, it's not that you're doing something bad, it's just that you're probably going to make it harder for yourself in the end because you're kind of setting up a dynamic of we're doing a trade thing around food instead of that clear message we can give children that they're born with, but we do tend to get in the way of it sometimes, which is, you know, we trust you. That's your body. You know what you need. You know when you're full. Okay, you're done. 2 bites today. Great. Sometimes I think of it like young children. It's like when we are pregnant and we are, you know, we're building a placenta and we're like building a baby and we're doing all this stuff and all this change is happening. And so we can only eat certain things, other things don't feel good. It changes our diet, right? Well, children are in a similar rapid development where Magda Gerber used to say, I bring her up a lot, she used to say, they wake up in their same room and the room looks different in the morning. They've changed overnight, even to that level. So, why do we expect that they're going to eat all the stuff? You know, they've got hormones going, they've got all kinds of things changing and shifting inside of them.
On this topic, like when my son eats with us, he always, takes a few bites and then he jumps out of his chair and he runs around and it's always, I never know whether to make him sit still, but he's also only 2.5, or to just kind of allow it and then he comes back when he wants a bite. I don't know if that's developing bad eating habits. My struggle as a parent is that boundary around, let's say, eating or even sleeping. It's a blurred line for me. So I guess that would.
Yes. And there's a reason it's a blurred line. Like certain boundaries are hard for us because you actually are more concerned that you're afraid he's not going to eat enough if you do a boundary. That's usually why people don't want to do boundaries around mealtime.
Yeah.
But a child that's even less than 1 year old, because I work with children that age and we do this in the classes that I do or used to do when we were able to get together, can understand that they sit while they're eating and when they're done, they can get up.
Yeah.
So we use these little table where they're sitting on the floor in the class, this table that they can all sit at if they want. And then we use these little stools that children can get in and out of easily. I mean, this is just a way to do things, but it helps them to feel that power of, you know what, I'm done. And I realize this doesn't set them up for the dinner party with the family or whatever, but ideally in the early years, that's going to be a rare situation because they're really not ready for it in the first few years. They're ready to eat. They're not ready to dine. They're not ready to hang out and we have coffee and we blah, blah, blah and talk. And that's a setup for failure for them because it's too hard. Anyway, with your son, I would decide and I would tell him, if you want to do this. I mean, nobody has to do any of this.
No, I want to.
Yeah. So I would say, I know we've let you get up and come back. We've let you do all this. And I know that daddy's been telling you to eat more or whatever. We decided, we trust you. You know what you need to eat when you don't. However, it's important to us that you stay sitting while you're eating and that when you get up, that's gonna tell us that you're done. So you're not saying, and this is how we're doing it in that kind of challenging voice. You're saying it very matter of fact. So we just wanna let you know that this is important to us. And I'll get into the reasons for sitting while you're eating. There's a lot of good reasons for it, but telling him so he gets the clear message. And then I would be fully attentive to him at mealtime. He's still a little guy.
Yeah.
So instead of thinking we're all gonna chat and talk, maybe that's not gonna happen right now at least, but one of you is paying full attention to him. So now you see him start to get up, right? Because you're paying full attention to him.
Yeah.
So you see him kind of wind down with the food or whatever he does, and then you see him start to get up. So right there, this is gonna help you to feel better about it, that's all. You're gonna put your hand on him, his shoulder or whatever.
Okay.
Be close enough where you can do that. And so stay sitting in, but put your hand and say, oh, it looks like you're getting up. So you're done, right? Right there, you're gonna get a really clear answer, right? So there, you've got your hand on him. He starts to get up. Okay, great, that's clear. Thanks for letting me know. And then if he comes back, instead of saying, no, we told you, and remember, you shouldn't have done that. Like that's gonna be maybe what we're impulsively thinking we should do or wanting to do. But instead of doing that, I would just say, oh shoot, now you change your mind and you wanna come back. I'm sorry, my love, but you know, we'll be eating again tomorrow for breakfast or whatever it is.
Putting that boundary and being like, sorry, you can't, you left.
Yeah, but being on his side about it, not being like, well, sorry, you didn't do it. But like, oh, it's so hard when you change your mind. And so it's like a very honest, very respectful way of having a very, very clear boundary. But if you give in, then there's no boundary and he doesn't have a way to ever learn that there's one. You know, if we say, oh, well, he's only two, let's give him another chance, then it's really hard for him to learn that there's a boundary because it's like this wobbly thing that he keeps having to test. And that becomes his whole focus of mealtime, not eating. So the reason to sit is because it helps us all to be mindful and pay attention. And again, that message from the tummy to the brain, that's so important.
And it gives a boundary, right?
Yeah. Gives a chance. So we're not multitasking and people say, well, I like to walk around and I eat and all that. Maybe for now, just these early years, maybe don't when your child's awake or around. When they're asleep, then you can do all this. But just so that you set these positive habits.
Yes.
And then later you can let them break them. But these early years is when the habits are formed. Children do have a lot going on in their minds all the time, but they're very easily distracted. And you know, it's just not gonna help them to do what you want them to do, which is eat all the food they need. I mean, that's your goal, right? That they get a healthy amount of food, just the right amount for them that they need. So for that goal, sitting is great. It's also, they can do it really, really young. Yeah.
So it's not about getting mad at them during mealtimes. It's not about threatening them during mealtimes. It's about setting that respectful boundary that still, you know, with it being sensitive and empathic and saying, oh, I'm so sorry, you left your seat. That was the cue that you changed. You didn't want to eat anymore. And then we took out your food. We can eat again for dinner. What ends up happening is we set that boundary. And if they leave, it's like a threat. Oh, okay, you're leaving. You're leaving. Okay, you're not going to eat anymore. Finish. And then when they come back for food, it's like a punishment, you know, and
yeah,
we avoid that. We are not punishing them.
Well, it's just unnecessary. Like we can be, it kind of makes us feel not so good either when respecting doesn't mean that we come down to their level and we're like, well, you did this, so we're not going to do that. And now I'm mad at you. We can be way up here and it feels so much better to be these giant people that we are to them with all the power. We have all so much power, much more than them. It feels so much better to rise tall and be the big person, right? But behind that has to be that trust, that you really do trust that if you get all these distractions out of the way, your child will eat the perfect amount for them. So that's what's underneath it. If we don't trust and our agenda is that our child eat these certain things or a certain amount of things, now it's going to be hard for us not to get mad, right? So when we have a feeling like that, I mean, going back to reparenting ourselves or whatever, there's a reason. It's the way that we're perceiving it. That's the reason. So if we're perceiving that it's our job to get children to eat, which a lot of parents think that they're not good parents unless they've gotten certain kinds of food into their child, but that's not our job and we can't control it. And it works so much better if we let go of it, picking up that extra piece of broccoli instead of saying, oh good, this is so good for you. You know, that's gonna blow it with these children that are trying to be their own people, right? We have to be, oh, okay, you sure? You want more? All right, sure, whatever, okay.
So it's funny, like you say those things because I feel that's what I've been doing. So I'm gonna change my approach to it and adjust. Okay, so I'm gonna move on to the next question. This is funny, I could relate to this. How to avoid raising entitled children. When I was just a new mom, I told my aunt, you know, I just don't want Balthazar to grow up spoiled, which I know in respectful parenting, we don't use the word spoiled, but I wasn't aware of it yet.
I don't know. That's not a rule.
And then, well, anyway, my aunt goes, why? Look how great you turned out. And I was like, is that a compliment? Yeah. So in the Philippines, a lot of brand new parents always put their children on a pedestal and they give them everything. And sometimes the children grow up to become entitled. So I guess this parent and I'm also asking how to avoid raising entitled children.
To have boundaries. If we don't have those firm boundaries around things, they learn that they are above boundaries, you know, but to them, it feels like, I think for children, they really underneath really do want those boundaries.
Yeah,
very much to feel loved, to feel that you care enough. Entitled children, or you could say spoiled or whatever, they're actually looking everywhere for someone to release them of this entitlement. I think they're looking for, and that's why they keep acting like that, because they actually want someone to lovingly put them in their place and say no. And they're not getting that. I mean, I think that is a direct result of that we were afraid to say no, or we, you know, let things go on and then we just blew up at them or whatever, but we didn't really give them that sense of that there's boundaries around things and there's things I can do and there's things I can't do. Everything has boundaries. And one thing that I learned also from my mentor is there's no freedom without boundaries. I mean, we all know that. Like if we don't have certain things in place in our society, then we have to worry a lot and feel uncomfortable and we don't feel free. Children are very much need this. So even with play, the way that we recommend starting with an infant and a toddler is that they have actually an enclosed part of a room or a room that we make for them so that they don't have this distraction, and some people say, oh, it's a jail. It's a thing. Well, children don't see it that way unless we suddenly put it up there when they're 2 and a half and now we're putting up stuff in front of them. But even then they kind of feel, okay, this is my safe area. This is my place where I can do whatever I want. You know, I've called it the yes space or whatever, but this is where I'm free in here, but that's within a boundary, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So yeah, children need boundaries. And if they don't have them, then they are left having to be adults, really. I mean, they're left having to be in charge and make all these decisions. And you see children sometimes that have grown up this way and they're kind of world weary, you know, at a young age, because they never got that feeling of we care enough to say no to this.
Children who grow up without boundaries, you say what the consequences would be? what?
I think a lot of different things, but well, one thing studies have shown is that they don't do as well, you know, in school or whatever. They don't fulfill their potential as learners or as, you know, achievers. So that's one thing that's actually been studied. They just feel that they never had a childhood, and they didn't. They didn't. That's the thing. So if I'm 2 or 3 years old and, you know, I have this feeling like whatever I say goes and I'm up on the pedestal, that's freaking scary, right? Yeah. Because I know that I don't know what I'm doing. I can't do that. And now I'm in charge of these adults. You know, how am I ever going to get comfortable and be able to focus on play and eating the right things and learning and discovering and doing all these childlike things that are really, really important? I'm not. I'm going to be like, oh, I got to control these people. And then you see children getting stuck. A lot of children I've worked with, but I help the parents get out of it, but their child is getting stuck, like controlling everybody. You know, you can hear it sometimes in their voice, like, I won't do that, you know, saying it to the parents and I'm not, you go away. And I don't, you know, you can see how they're kind of so tightly stuck in this controlled person that they don't want to be, but they get stuck there. Yeah. And then you'll see a child and everyone will say, oh, that child's a brat or that child's a this or that. But they're just, I feel for them because they just need to cry about you saying no to, you know, things that they are testing, and they need to release some of that stuff that they're holding on to.
It's funny you say they need to cry for you to say no, because sometimes we see that as a threat. And I used to be like this, like, you don't want them to cry, so you're going to allow them to do things. But now after speaking to you and you say that with a child without boundaries, it's kind of counterproductive because they grow up without a childhood, so to speak, because they were kind of put on the pedestal and they were the boss, and they grow up in, as adults lacking boundaries, right? So that's very, very insightful. I'm definitely learning so much.
I didn't make it up. But thank you.
I'm going to move on to another question, very controversial. Do you believe in spanking as discipline? When children are bad, you know, hitting them on the butt and even maybe explaining to them or not explaining to them, it's kind of like a punishment. Again, going back to that, but using physical punishment. What's your take on that?
It's not controversial for me, I have to say. It's something very, very clear for me. Maybe also because my parents didn't spank, so it's very clear to me that that's not something, you know, that hurting somebody to try to teach them, especially if they're a child and very absorbent and vulnerable and open. I mean, all you have to do with a child is say, like, have a little look in your eye, and it's like vibrates through them. So all it does is teach, and going back to what we do with respectful parenting, was developing a relationship of trust and respect. And there's no trust if you're going to hurt me. I can't trust you. I can't trust myself because I'm doing things that are causing me to get hurt, and doesn't breed security. And, you know, it's teaching that hurting people is a solution, you know, just a way to be. Again, this reparenting is quite hard because we will have that urge every time something goes wrong.
What if the person explains it? Because I know of somebody, they say that, you know, we spank our child, but then we explain, you know, I did this because of I love you and because you were naughty, because you, you know, I don't know, drew on the walls and stuff. And I'm always just listening. I never want to impose my beliefs on them, because that's their beliefs. But it's true that when you spank a child, it's like teaching them that that's the solution to it. And I don't know what the effect is on the child, even though the parent explains, I did this because I love you.
Well, there actually is a lot of science on this. And the science shows that the outcomes for children that have been spanked are not positive. They're more likely to be aggressive. They're more likely to go to jail. I hate to say it. They're more likely to choose partners that are physically abusive. So there is a lot of science. And actually, the science also shows that if this happens, if spanking happens, it is much easier for the child to understand if it comes out of anger. So, which is the way it usually does, that the parent just does it. And even a very young child on some level understands aggression and the feeling that makes you want to hit and makes you want to lash out at somebody, but they don't understand that they would just be hurt out of love. But again, they're tying it together. So when people love you, they physically hurt you. that's part of it. And so they will choose those partners. You know, if there's anything you're going to do reparenting, that's
one of them.
Number one, because there really is a lot of science and it's quite stark.